Today I'm going to present my master's thesis work, Multiscale and Multimodal Streaming Data Aggregation and Processing for Decision Support During Natural Disasters. Disaster Record is the tool that was an outcome of this work. My committee members, Dr. Prasad, my advisor, Dr. Sheth, Dr. Shalin, and mentor Hussain. Recent past has seen a number of disasters which resulted in massive destruction, loss in economy, and had long-lasting effect on day-to-day lives of affected people. During each of these natural disasters, there are smaller events that evolve as a result, which needs timely attention, like power outages or block loads. Timely, accurate decisions and response to these events can minimize the cost of rehabilitation. For such critical decisions, we need to know what has happened, when it has happened, and where it has happened. Timely extraction of this information, integration, and organization for a real-time response is challenging. With this, we come to our problem definition. Given a disaster event with a known spatial context, can we extract the knowledge from multimodal data, including targeted crowdsourced data, Twitter stream, satellite imagery, and pre-disaster data, and intertwine them with locations on the map to provide decision support for real-time situational awareness? We'll start with a use case to explain our problem better. So from Twitter, we get text messages like, for example, I'm stuck at XYZ, help me. The nuggets of information that can be extracted from these are needs and location. For example, stuck is the need here and XYZ is the location. Our overall goal is to provide a decision support in the form of need matching. These needs at these locations need to be matched to a location that provides these needs. And for that, we resort to another source of data that are OpenStreetMap, which provides us locations. But we cannot just match them as it is. We need to know the type of the need and type of the location. For the type of the need, we can have a classifier that tells us the need, the kind of need. And for the location type, we need to have a knowledge base that tells us the location affordability. And thus, we have constructed a location-centric ontology that has two modules. One, the location affordability, and even helps in improving the results of need classification. Now, being able to match these needs, we provide our novel approach of satellite imagery that provides us with flood mapping. And with all of this, we provide decision support. In the rest of the slides, we will follow this flow. We will start with need classification, describe the kinds of data used in it, then go to location-centric ontology, how it improves need classification and provides location affordability, and then provide the decision support scenario. The system architecture of the pipeline consists of three major contributions: the multimodal data coming from various sources, the location-specific functionalities, and the decision support need matching. The three kinds of data. Kinds of data that we are using are pre-disaster data, streaming and crowdsourced data, satellite imagery. We will introduce pre-disaster data in the context of location-centric ontology and satellite imagery in the context of need matching. While starting with need matching, need classification, we introduce our first kind of data, that is streaming data. Twitter forms the major source of information for our work. Thousands of people post every day their daily activities, and numerous tweets are recorded during a major natural disaster. Surveys have proved that among such big data, there might be bias false or unverified information, but there is still a significant number of relevant and meaningful information that can be gleaned out. We crawl significant amount of data for major disasters. The text streams were filtered using hashtags and disaster event related keywords. Let us look into a tweet that was posted during Chennai 2015 rain. It said, hashtag Chennai floods, Ashok Nagar, no food, no water, no power. They need immediate help, SOS. The tweet comes with metadata like user profile information, name, location, tweet time, external multimedia. As we said earlier, we want to know what has happened and where it has happened and when. So the when can be answered with the tweet's timestamp. The rest, the neat classification gives us the what, and the location mentioned in the text gives us the where. So our two requirements from the text are the locations and the needs. We extract the locations using our tool Linux that I am going to explain in some time, and extract the needs by having a classifier that helps us with this. So in the literature, in the disaster text classification literature, there have been work to classify the kinds of disaster, say the hydrological disaster or a climatological disaster. The other works concentrate on finer grained classes like affected people, injured, missing, donation, volunteers, etc. And one another work that does binary classification for infrastructure damage. Just this one, the last one, has a visualization on the map and provides clustering based on location. Every other disaster text classification do not have any actionable details. Further, Cameron et al. Visualized the geotag tweets on a map. But about only 2-4% of data are geotag. If we end up relying on such geotag tweets, we would miss out on a lot of critical information. Therefore, we resort to our tool, Linux, that extracts location names from text data and attaches each of these locations to their latitude and longitude information on the map. The text data is then classified into one of the need classes. We care more about the locations that is talked about rather than the location it came from. We visualize locations from a context of a need, which can locate the need on a map. For example, in this particular, the previous example we saw, the location that is talked about is Chennai and Ashok Nagar. But if I have to look into the location that was received from the metadata, it goes to Mumbai, which is about 800 miles away from the disaster that happened. So once we have the location extracted from the text, we need to extract the kind of need that the text is talking about. For this, the data sources that we use to train our classifier were Crisis Lex and Crisis NLP. Each of them had around 11 classes, which were fine-grained classes like donations, volunteering, displaced, evacuation, all of this. So we merged all of we repurposed the fine-grained classes to form coarse-grained classes, matching our needs. So the classes like donations, volunteering, displaced people, evacuation, all of them fall into shelter or food or supplies need. And classes like missing people, death reports, injured, affected, fall into medical and rescue help needs. Moving on, we use these labeled data to train our classifier. The very first step we did was pre-process the data. We did stemming, case folding, and removal of noisy lexical terms like URLs, ASCII characters, mentions, punctuations, data-specific stop words removal, and hashtags. The data-specific stop word removal were critical, proved to be critical because the dataset was composed of several disaster events which had tweets like, for example, Nepal earthquake. Something like Nepal earthquake needs people as volunteers. So if one data set was more rescue centric, the entire classifier was getting a little biased towards that kind of classification. Therefore, it was important to remove them, and then we moved for to do feature engineering. We played around with several features and resorted to these two features, and the combination of the two gave us good F score. We used the two classes that we were working had imbalance, and so we solved it using SMOT, which synthetically oversampled the minority classes. So SVM SMOT focuses on generating new minority classes, class instances near the boundaries, and this boundary is defined by SVM. And so it worked. It showed a significant improvement in our results. Out of all the classifiers, the classifier that worked best with our data was gradient boosting classifier. But this particular F-score was still not good enough with our requirements. We needed to improve that, and so we went further to design our location-centric ontology, which has two modules, a part that helps in improving the need classification and the other that defines the OSM location affordability. We will introduce...
Before you go further, what was your classes and what are the minority classes?
So our need classes are shelter food supplies need, and the other classes medical rescue help need. Minority was the shelter food supplies need. And since the, it was a little imbalanced, we used SMOT to balance the...
So it's a binary classification?
Yes. So in our location-centric ontology, the kinds of data that we used are these. One were from the crowdsourced data, the Excel sheets. These were the Excel sheets that were circulated among the volunteers during the Chennai floods, and the knowledge extracted from these crowdsourced Excel sheets provide situational awareness and various kinds of information available at each location. For example, in this particular case, the location Alpakkam in Chennai provided relief materials. This was critical for the people who needed such relief materials and the volunteers to coordinate. The other kind of data that we used was pre-disaster data. Pre-disaster data provided us with available locations inside a bounding box. As pre-disaster data, we used OpenStreetMap. OSM is a gazetteer of location names. With metadata, it includes all existing locations on Earth, including street names, highways, towns, cities, states, country. And the metadata includes geo-coordinates, key value pair explaining the type of the location. For example, a building can be a hospital or can be a supermarket. And their parents that they belong to, for example, a street belongs to a city, and so on. These were captured using a bounding box of the disaster event. These help us, these locations finally helped us in matching the needs that we receive from text data. So explaining what we require from our event ontology, is right now we have tweets that express the needs, be it shelter or rescue, and OpenStreetMap locations that contain the types of locations that are inside a bounding box. Therefore, we need a way to match a need with a particular location, and that is why we build the ontology to express the affordability of locations for us to support the matching functionality. And also, to improve our need classifier, we included the ontology concepts which represent a given need and use these concepts to improve our classifier later. So for the same, for need classification, we have provided the ontology with concepts with lexicon features, and for matching need matching, we provided it with location features with relationship to these concepts. For example, in our case, I'm stuck at XYZ, the location XYZ, and the need stuck means I need a rescue at the location XYZ, and our matching functionality should show the nearby locations that can afford this particular response. For example, a hospital or an emergency response team. In this particular example also, I broke my leg, we can classify it as medical need, and then a similar medical help can be provided by Kindred Hospital, which the ontology tells us that is a medical help availability. Going into the literature, first we went into the literature, and first we listed down our requirements as competency questions, and then tested them against the literature. Our competency questions, we required the coverage of disaster concepts plus a good depth of knowledge, including spatial, temporal, thematic, and response details. So in the literature, the lexicons, crisis in LP, crisis lex, that Kreese used were merely lexicons. They did not have any explicit relationships between the concepts. They were about 11 classes as a whole, and then they provided information type and crisis types. So we used them as labels for classification. They did not satisfy any of our requirements, and so we used it just as a training data. And these MOAC and HXL are the two I would call the giants in the field. They were the so MOAC is claims to address who, what, where, but for they do cover a lot of concepts in disaster, but do not have the proper depth. They do not provide a spatial or temporal. They do say that they give temporal details, but that do not satisfy our requirements. They have thematic details, but no response details. On the other hand, HXL relies more on semantic web technologies and linked open data, and reuses generic ontologies rather than event ontologies or disaster-centric concepts. So they do not have coverage over depth, coverage of the disaster-related concepts, spatial, temporal, or response details. SOX and SOX is our own from our group, which extended HXL and MOAC, but does not cover the requirements. EDXL Rescuer is a very good ontology, but it is for data exchange with legacy systems. It is not compatible with social media data, and so we could not reuse it. But the ones that that combines crisis domain with social media falls short with the kind of concepts they have. They have coarse grained concepts rather than the depth we require. And then Wang et al. Has good coverage of concepts, but has no hierarchical relationship between the concepts. They are just few classes there.
So question. So you go to that. Yeah, so for example, now when you mention spatial details, so what kind of, so are they using existing lexicon? Let's say the locations that are existing in OpenStreetMap, or they define new locations in themselves in this kind of ontology that
so locations, like if a particular concept like rescue help or something like that is available at kind of location. So in our case, we have OpenStreetMap that provides this spatial details. In their case, they have the kinds of requirements and the kinds of location they can be seen at.
No, so I mean when they mention that they cover spatial details, are they borrowing some information from some resource which is out there, or they themselves also have something like OpenStreetMap?
Yes. Oh, okay. Not OpenStreetMap, but they have something out there.
Oh, okay.
But the point is, so if I understand correctly, the OpenStreetMap has already this concept of spatial aggregation, right? So you have county, county has towns and cities and things
right.
of that nature, right?
Yes.
And if they have used some alternative which don't have that, then there's a big distinction, right? Because you can't, without this spatial aggregation, a lot of things can't be done very well. Right?
So do you names do not have, or other ones other than OpenStreetMap, they do not have as many finding name locations as OpenStreetMap? So for example, you will not find all the hospitals or all the points of interest as you can find in OpenStreetMap, and that's why we use OpenStreetMap, which is not a link to the use of this.
I didn't mean to say your names if I didn't say that. But OpenStreetMap and whatever knowledge base that you are using has the spatial aggregation. Mm-hmm. If the and the question was the answer to Amit's question was that the others also have used some knowledge base. But if that those knowledge base did not support spatial aggregation, then the kind of things they can do. I also, you know, Shruti showed some of them don't have either location, they don't have hierarchy. So if they don't have those concepts, then the kind of things you can do are severely limited, because you have you kind of have location name match that you can do, but you can't talk about a region, you can't talk about area, you can't talk about, you know, spatial extent.
So the main difference is, if you go back, is they do not support any response details, which means,
I have
the location information, but what do I do with that, right? Nobody's doing the location affordability modeling, which is what we do here for need matching.
So we used whatever was there in the literature. We designed our ontology in a way that references the classes that are present in the literature, and then bridges the gaps that were missing in our requirements. So our ontology makes distinct distinction between the response and relief phase of the disaster, and introduces two kinds of concepts: needs and availability. Needs that helps us in our need classification, and availability gives us OSM location affordability information. So we will discuss.
Again, what does location affordability mean? What needs can be satisfied at a given location?
At a given location, yes. For example, in the rescue case, a hospital is eligible to support such a need, and emergency responders' locations have some name, that particular.
So you use both location information and the need to figure out the match?
Yes. For the concept needs, we started to topic modeling. We started with the label data that we have, and pre-processed them and cleaned the data. After cleaning, we used LDA. LDA is latent Dirichlet allocation, probabilistic topic model, which gives us the distribution of words with the presence of topics in it. It gives us two intermediary matrices that are topic to document and word to topic, and then with Dirichlet priors, we control the distribution, and then at the end we get the words that belong to the number of topics that we have in the complete document.
So the label that you just mentioned, that we have label data, you got it from the, basically based on the ontology that you have used? You just mentioned that you run LDA on label data?
Yes.
So first you map it with ontology and then you run LDA.
Okay, so until now, this is how I have introduced the words in the ontology. I have not formed my ontology yet.
Oh, okay.
This is how I'm approaching to encode all of it in the ontology.
So remember the data that she saved, she unifies the fine-grained labels into two cross-grained ones.
Yeah.
This is what she's doing. She's running it on the two cross-grained plane.
And then we get terms like relief, donate, food belonging to the shelter topic, and death, injured, missing belonging to the medical or rescue topic. Then while critically examining each of these words, we came across many ambiguous terms like hospital or water, which can belong to, if I talk about water from a perspective of our classes, it is justifiable to have water in our shelter need. But then if I see the, look at the tweets inside, if someone's saying there's water all around me, I cannot justify that as a shelter need. And so we reviewed all these words, and then finally decided to keep few of them, the ones that completely justify our use case, and then move forward. But there was a critical problem we noticed. The words as output comes from comes with a probability relevance of the topic, and so we wanted to use these as weights to rank the words in a text stream for as priority. But the range of probabilities of words from the two classes were different, and thus we were incomparable. Therefore, we resorted to normalizing to a different but a common range, and then finally use these weights to multiply with the frequency of their occurrences. And this is how we, with the words that we received, we model encoded them in our needs concept, and then which was used to improve our classification, which actually improved a lot. We could see a significant improvement with having a knowledge base supporting the classification. The second part of our ontology was to support location affordability. And so we went to OpenStreetMap, collected all the key value pairs of the locations that we are meant to satisfy the kinds of needs we are working with, and then encoded them in the ontology. As in the example, the rescue availability can be is available as a social facility. These locations are available as rescue availability, like fire station, rescue station, provide rescue availability. So, concluding this particular section with our competency questions, we have covered the depth, breadth. It can be extendable. These are a few concepts that can be extendable. We have covered spatial details. Temporal details are the only things that we did not cover. Thematic and response we covered. Temporal details, like there are a few events that expire after some time. For example, blocked roads. Our ontology does not cover that, cover the evolution of events dynamically. This is a very strong future work that can be looked at after this. So right now we have our needs classified. We have our location affordance information. The next step we want to do is need matching. For this we first visualize needs classified and location affordances on a map that is provided by Mapbox, and provide directions with Mapbox's directions API from the seekers to the providers, and provide a scenario dissemination. In the literature of need matching, we have seen a few using handcrafted rules, others using structured inputs that utilizes moderators in the loop to manually match the needs, and then there have been work that quantifies the degree of impact of a disaster and prioritizes the matching accordingly, provides online and offline solution for requesting, providing, and coordinating resources. But all of this, these have one faulty assumption that all routes are available for matching during a disaster. And the matching problem is being solved at a different granularity than what our requirement is. So as of now, we have from the stream streams, we have the locations that Linux extracted. The classifier could tell us the need, and that's how we got need locations. From the ontology, which gave us need concepts, which improved our classification and also helped in location affordability and gave us available locations. Now we want to do need matching. For this, we introduce our new our novel method, flood mapping. This forms the third and the last data source, but this is one of the most important source of data. Satellite imagery is used for flood mapping of the affected area. This was a tool developed by our team at OSU that takes in a satellite image and interpolate it with the actual map of the region and finds the geo-coordinates that are flooded with any precision value that you require. So the output of the flood mapping tool is a bitmap representing geo-coordinates with Boolean values representing flooded or not. These flooded geo-coordinates are used in two ways: to eliminate flooded OpenStreetMap locations and to prune away flooded, closed or inaccessible routes. In the figure you can see, each grid is, for example, a geo-coordinate, and the ones that are in blue are, for example, if are flooded. The routes that go over these flooded flooded regions are not accepted while matching the two locations from source to destination. And this is how we provide our flood our need matching. And after a need match matching, we provide information with directions as well as the destination information, contact information. The last part of was data visualization. We cache all of the information that was collected and cache them in Elasticsearch. Then we create a map layers on top of Mapbox. Each layer of the map represents a theme of data, providing visual hierarchy in and the separation of map layers into planes of information. In the literature, we have seen visualization as part of heat maps, how the event unfolds and the criticality, the frequency of tweets, or there have been works that place markers as for the geotagged tweets. Then there have been works where they use structured input or visually show the histogram and comparison. There have been one work that uses the layered visualization, incorporating weather data and clustering. We use layers of information for our visualization, each of the layers coming from different source of data, and each of which, and again, differentiating among the kind of data we get. D-Record is meant for two kinds of users. One is community level user, another individual level users. We have two separate functionalities for each of them. In the aggregation level of analysis, disaster record analyzes, categorizes, and geolocates locations, location names extracted from non-geo-referenced tweets, and it visualizes aggregate information in a selected geographical bounding box. It eliminates the low-level clutter to surface essential information about disaster to the responders. It also abstracts and categorizes data to provide community-level analysis and insights. Upon choosing a location of interest by drawing a bounding box, we get location-specific textual data, categorizing tweets to need types and aggregating tweets with respect to location vicinity. Then location-specific image features, filtering of flooded images, and then detecting objects of interest to assess severity and needs, including objects like people to allow learning about disaster impact, animals for monitoring livestock, and vehicles to assess traffic maneuverability.
I think one way to frame it is that while the alternatives that you discussed focus on different way of conveying the information. You have looked at more of an action level information kind of thing. We looked at more on how you transcend different levels of different modality, different level of information, selection of different geographical areas and time to be able to make a decision. It's not a static representation of a thing at a point of time. It's more of a dynamic situation plus doing a different level of aggregation with heterogeneous modalities. That is how you want to put it, which allows, which is action-centric rather than information convey, you know, static information convey-centric.
Right. That was the major requirement of our work, that we wanted to provide response details for the users. And then provide location-specific available help by categorizing the OpenStreetMap features into types and their counts. Location-specific thematic profile by highlighting and summarizing the most discussed concepts in a region. In the individual level of analysis, it provides, it preserves low-level details to provide individuals with the situational awareness and the kind of available help for their particular needs. The flooded areas and then possible available help and then route guidance of non-flooded routes for relief workers and individuals seeking help. Finally, the number of the results came out to be this. The original number of tweets that we started with were these for each of the data sets, Chennai and Houston, and Linux could extract almost about half of the tweets with locations mentioned. If we were going with just geotagged tweets, I'm sure it would have been lesser than this. The number of needs that we extracted were almost 1/4 in each of these locations, and then OSM provided us with locations of almost 1,400 and 3,000 in both the data sets. In conclusion, our tool is able to work with multimodal data and provides need matching for individual level of users and data aggregate information for a community level user. We showed how a domain specific location centric event ontology is crucial for situational awareness in a disaster response scenario. Then we have demonstrated a modularized pipeline that can be replaced, plugged out and in with any other functionalities. And then as a future work, we have worked on coarse-grained data. We can definitely focus on a finer level classification and then add more background knowledge such as weather data, and then currently using storm surge model can help us in providing more preparedness, not just response. Then online and offline infrastructure is a crucial need at the moment. Then studying the geotag location and the combination of geotag location and the location names mentioned during an event can probably infer the fake or trust related to the tweet from a location's perspective, and then weighing the edges of road network based on flood mapping to reduce the ETAs between the while solving the matching problem. These are the references that were covered throughout the slides, and on the paper that was the outcome is provided at that link with a video that provides the entire functioning of the tool, a wiki page, a short summary, GitHub repo, and the ontology links are provided. And finally, thank you all for attending. And I would like to thank my advisor who has helped me a lot from day one. He has been a great support throughout, and I think there's this one proverb that I actually saw it, I experienced it with him, that a problem well stated is half solved. So each time I went with a problem, he rephrased it in a way that gave me almost a solution that could let me move ahead. Then Dr. Sheth, you have been a great inspiration, the way you manage everything and the way you encourage all the students and have supported me throughout for participation in Call for Code and everything. The trust that you had that we can do something, that really made a lot of difference. And Dr. Shalin, you have been the sweetest here, and
that's
because every week that when we meet, she always would thank me for my small little work and would encourage. All of those small encouragements inspired me every other week to do a little more.
Right, so not quite so sweet.
No, that's the way I perceive it. And then Hussain. Hussain has been that one filter between the professors and me. Everything I do first goes to Hussain, and then after he confirms, it goes to the next higher authority. He has been working with me throughout and has helped me in every... He made sure I was not blocked with any kind of problems. He was there always, be it 2 in the night, or he's there. And then Srini from OSUN, he was kind enough to provide us with the data that we required and was a great collaborator to work with. Then the team members of Call for Code Disaster Record, Mike, Dipesh, Hussain, all of them worked really hard at time critical situation, and we did good. Jeremy, who helped us with UI design and his feedbacks, and Alan, who was able to collaborate during Kerala floods and was also a time-critical situation where he could help me with. And to the entire Noesis family for encouraging me every Monday morning to go for the week. And then the collaborators from OSU who provided us with the data, and ultimately the ultimately NSF, who was able to support this work. Thank you.
Yeah, I want to explicitly acknowledge that Hussain has been an exemplary mentor.
The shape of this, my work is like this at this point of time, is because of him. He had all the directions what...
So where do we go from here?
with this work, mm-hmm. I think I will. So the thing I mentioned previous summer, I had started modeling an ontology that we again came back to this particular use case and we modeled this one. But that particular ontology where we were looking at evolution of events with the time expiration and all of that. Probably I want to look a little more. I'm interested to address that problem at the.
So do you have any comments on the way you build a classifier? It seems too coarse grained. So do you have any comments on making it fine grained as an improvement, or is probably not conforming to how things are?
So in a real situation, if I would have classes that were telling me that this particular location needs food and that needs water, but ultimately the one helping out would be the same source, so it would not matter as much. But fine grained would from a responder's perspective would be able to see more
precisely
concepts.
What is needed.
Yes,
I think if I understand correctly, fine grained in the sense of getting more specific location or anything probably is not that useful, because ultimately human judgment will call for. But I think the concept I've heard called catchment area, and being able to sort of say, what is the need in this catchment area? That's the way of their thinking.
The more vulnerable to flooding, I mean, that's what...
No, the catchment area is the area that they're serving, I believe. Or a particular area that they have responsibility for. So, you know, I am responsible for Anandnagar or whatever that location is, and in that, what is the responsibility? What do they need most? And being able to see that way.
So again, the importance of location-specific.
Location-specific, but
so the right level of
whatever arbitrary way they see to be their area of influence or impact or service that they serve. So in a way, thinking, understanding how they think and how do they plan. So as Hussein was communicating with this guy, you know, the people in humanitarian space, that term came, you know, seemed to get that is a term that they are interested in, by catchment area, saying, give me the needs by this catchment area.
So actually, if you look at our cross-grained, you know, classes, we are partially solving the problem of catchment area, because if you have food, or you want food, we are directing you to the nearest shelter, right? So making these shelters as catchment areas for providing such kind of needs.
Right. What I see, you know, is what is doable is, first of all, you're giving arbitrary place. You can draw a rectangle, so that itself is good. But and beyond that, you'd be able to, you know, for example, when I was doing treaties for Chennai floods, I used a search and then typed in the, you know, neighborhood name to find the tweets from that location. Now, what I would want here is to be able to type in the, say, my neighborhood, catchment area, that neighborhood, and that, or that community, or that zip code, and that for that give me the supply and demand.
You know, actually, our aggregation does that now. So if we draw a bounding box on top of Chennai Airport, and we were able to know that, you know, people are stuck there, they need rescue help, and so on and so forth.
Mm.
So that's actually part of the demo that we've done for the code for code.
So how do you, so this is my question. So let's say, because the community level analysis, let's say you want to basically represent what are the needs here. So you use ontology for representing, or you use your topic models to show what are the entities or what is the basically needs for this specific area? I didn't get this part.
So when I draw a bounding box at an area, it gives me all the locations with needs. So how our ontology has helped us in telling us that this particular location can provide a shelter need, and then from the text, we can tell that this is a shelter need, and then provide all of that data here. For example, in this particular bounding box, I can see how many shelters are available and how many these are available. All of this in the background, my ontology works to provide me these data. And then we all the locations that we mentioned, we have that listed here, and which we can ultimately peek into them and then see what kinds of tweets they are, and then have a word cloud that tells us what are the things that are spoken about in that particular area at that particular time.
So I think we need to differentiate between two things. The data that is coming from the tweets, mm-hmm. right? So these are the tweets that tell you that I need this kind of rescue, or I need a shelter or whatever, mm-hmm. right? And these are the locations. For example, I say that I'm in this location, I need this help, right? Mm-hmm. And this is where we use Linux to extract those locations.
Mm-hmm.
That's different from the locations that we get from OpenStreetMap, and we, you know, we codify in the ontology to represent the affordability, meaning that, you know, a hospital is there anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if somebody mention it or not mention it, that's you know, not relevant to now what we're talking about. If you show that you need rescue,
yeah.
I can match you with a hospital that I know is available.
Oh, okay.
Right? So That's a difference.
No, I was thinking that, for example, you are gonna say that you are gonna show that this specific region needs blanket. I was thinking of this.
We do that too.
Oh, you did it.
So if you draw that bounding box,
yeah,
we aggregate that need, right? And then we show them.
Yeah.
We show that, for example, 50 of the tweets are needing rescue. 30 of them are needing shelter.
Yeah,
so that's it.
Yeah, this is, we are going to use this idea.
So where did your competency requirements come from? You had 5 or 6 or something like that. Where did they come from?
They were our requirements for the program.
Okay, so that would be a contribution. given that there were 5 or 6, I don't remember how many there were, did you find any of the existing ontologies to be a useful point of departure? I guess 6. or did you find any of the ones that existed to be useful, or did you have to throw everything away and start over? And if so, why?
Yes. So I was able to use few of the concepts of MOAC, since we said MOAC has breadth of. We said MOAC has good coverage of concepts, but does lack the breadth, and then they are just 2 levels. There's no hierarchy in those. We also need the depth. So I could utilize their concepts and then provide the depth in our ontology with the words that came out as a result of topic modeling.
Okay, so you can add to that the hierarchical stuff, the spatial detail, and the response details. Because one of the things that I'm worried about is how many new ones we have to make for every single application that we have, and if it's possible for me to start with something that exists and then add to it. So that would be your best guess is MOAC.
Yes.
Okay.
So can you clearly verbalize the role of topic modeling in your work?
So I've used topic modeling to discover the class-related concepts that are specific to each class, and then be able to define those concepts whenever those concepts are we come across while need classification. I can create a vector saying that this particular term is telling me that this is belonging to this particular class. And not just that, if there is a particular tweet that has terms from both the classes, I go with the relevance score and then multiply with the frequency of the words that are present, and then form a vector that is again appended as a feature vector while classification.
So for each class, you curated a weighted lexicon.
Yes.
Using topic modeling.